Reading for this morning comes from 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 13 through 17. No testing has overtaken you that is not common to everyone. God is faithful, and he will not let you be tested beyond your strength. But with the testing, he will also provide the way out so that you may be able to endure it. Therefore, my dear friends, flee from the worship of idols. Speak as to sensible people. Judge for yourselves what I say. The cup of blessing that we bless, is it not a sharing in the blood of Christ? The bread that we break, is it not a sharing in the body of Christ? Because there is one bread, we who are many are one body, for we all partake of the one bread.
Thanks, Jack. I want to check to make sure the mic's working. The question I have for us to begin with today is, do you have something worth communicating? I know that communion worries some people who are Christian. They think it ought to be a great mystical experience. And it may be for a few of you. But for most of us, it isn't. We are not transported to the seventh heaven by the munching of a piece of bread. And we do not see visions after a thimbleful of grape juice. We eat the bread and we drink the wine in remembrance of Christ's body, broken for us, and his blood that was shed on the cross for us. We reenact what God did for us that we cannot do for ourselves. It's as simple and as magnificent as that. Now, if you find communion empty and meaningless, it may be because you are spiritualizing the material. You may be trying to load this simple meal with too much mystical experience and freight. Now, may I suggest that instead of spiritualizing the material, you need to materialize the spiritual. That's what Jesus' whole life and ministry was. It was a putting into material flesh and blood the spiritual principles of love. And that's what he did at the Last Supper. He put spiritual reality into material form. Henceforth, the disciples could not eat another meal without thinking of him. Today, I'm going to suggest that we're going to experiment. And if those of you who know me well know that I sometimes get into some weird things. But we're going to experiment with materializing the spiritual. And that is what it is. It's communicating with God and with one another. I'm going to tell you a story about myself. It begins in La Porte, Indiana, back in the 70s. Now, you might understand this. What if you had to teach 44 seventh and eighth graders confirmation, and you knew that on Easter you were going to take those children to Syracuse to baptize three of them? Now remember, this is March in Indiana. You're going to baptize them in the water. of the lake. The rest of them were smarter. In one sense of the word, that they didn't have to go in the lake. But we were going to have First Communion for these young people. Now, last week, we saw the youth bringing the candles. Remember that? Blew them out and lit them again. Well, I decided I was smarter than most people, which is very, very wrong. I decided that I was going to do a different kind of communion. What I asked the kids to do, and they all got chairs around the communion table, and on the communion table were the bread and the juice. And I had a bowl, and I gave each one of them a piece of paper and a pencil, which I almost thought about giving those to you, where they could write down something that they would like God's forgiveness for. So I gave them time to do that. And since I was the only one that played the piano, I went over and started to play the piano. Let us break bread together, while they took their sins up to put in the bowl, and they were supposed to take them and light the candle and put it in the bowl. I thought they would do it one at a time. Suddenly, as I'm playing, I hear the following. Pastor, Pastor, what are we going to do? I turned around, and this bowl was full of flame. It was shooting right up. So I did what every pastor would do. I looked around for a fire extinguisher. There wasn't any fire extinguisher in that chapel. So I did the one thing that I knew would work. Guess what I did? I took the jug of wine that they were going to have First Communion, and I doubt. They will never forget their First Communion. Do you remember your First Communion? The first time you felt somehow inside that as you tasted the bread and drank the juice, you realized that Jesus wipes away all sin. That the gift that he has given us is a fabulous gift. And so when you make that material, you understand how important this meal is. Now, we have a great advances in communication. The Census Bureau tells us that we have more televisions in our house than we have cars, and we have more cars than we have phones, so I don't think that's still true. But we want to communicate. But my concern is today is, do we have something worth communicating? My constant nightmare, especially when they ask me to preach, is that I won't have anything to say. Do you have something to say for all of our modern buildings, for the beautiful communion table, to the new sound system that we're going to be getting, I think. Is that right? Or maybe we already have it. All radio, television, public relations experts, will we have something to say? A cartoon appeared recently, some time ago, that showed the runner from the Battle of Thermopylae running with a torch in his hand to the people at Athens. He ran, what was it? Those of you who run, 26 miles? And when he got there in this cartoon, they were all waiting to hear the message. And guess what he said in the cartoon? I forgot the message. Do you know what you are proclaiming? Do you believe what you hear? I want to remind us that communion is several things, but one of the things it most importantly is, it's the way that the people of God hear that God loves us. God loves us. How many of you men tell your wife, "I love you"? I won't ask you to raise your hands because I think some of you might be embarrassed. How many of you women tell your spouse you love them? How many of you tell your children, "I love you"? God gives us every time we take the sacrament, "I love you." It's as simple as that. I'm going to list up some other ideas for you to think about. Communion reminds us that deeds are more important than creeds. Now, we have some of our congregation, Jeff leading them, or Ruth, maybe, I'm not sure who leads in that family, are there with members of our congregation who are showing by their actions that their deeds are more important than what they say or do. They're showing it by their actions. My constant nightmare is that the church won't have anything to say. The world is always, always wanting to hear about the unspeakable love of God through Jesus Christ. And communion does just that. It's not an optional extra. Let me explain what I mean. How many have taken communion in a Methodist church? How many of you have taken communion in a Methodist, not a Methodist church, but in a Lutheran church? I want you to look around. How many of you have taken it in a Catholic church? How many have taken it in a Buddhist temple? I don't think there's anybody here that did that. Let me explain what I mean. We sometimes get all worked up about being Presbyterian. Most of the choir knows this. Maybe you don't know it, but I'm a Methbyterian. Do you understand what that means? It means I'm a Methodist and a Presbyterian. I've learned a few things about communion, though, in my lifetime. I learned that there are certain churches that won't let you take communion if you don't belong to that church. I used to believe that until I discovered an interesting thing. I was served communion in the Basilica of Notre Dame. Do you know, everybody know what Notre Dame is, besides being a football team? When I went to Omer Amigal, it was raining. We went to a Lutheran church. And the pastor there said, "Pastor Tom, will you help me celebrate communion?" And I looked at the chalice, and it was white. I never served communion that looked white till I tasted it. And then I knew it was wine. What I'm trying to say is, God's people don't have to have a label to hear the word of the Lord coming in the material bread and juice. It can happen at any time because God loves us. I want to say another thing. While deeds are more important than creeds, communion is such that the senses are more important than making sense out of it. Many a pastor has tried very, very hard to make sense and lose sight of the pew sitter's five senses. What are the five senses we have? You know them: sight, smell, hearing, taste, and touch. The best way I know to keep a congregation awake, you know how I can keep you awake? I want you to picture this in your mind. Steak
barbecuing over charcoal. Hot biscuits dripping with honey. Waffles, oh, waffles swimming in a pool of melted butter. Now I guarantee you, your saliva glands will begin to secrete as surely as Pavlov's dogs. That's just what happens in communion. Donald McLellan says we get beyond sense to the five senses. We see with our eyes the actions of a simple meal being served. We take into our hands the elements. We taste the bread. We roll it around in our mouth. And we drink the juice. And we swallow and take it into our very bodies, the symbols of the broken body and shed blood. And our minds go back to that upper room in a garden at a hilltop, and we begin to feel with our whole being the incredible love of God. Communion, my friends, communicates where words fail, because it gets beyond sense to our senses. There's another thing that communion communicates, and that is that symbols are more important than syllables. I want you to picture in your mind my first little church. Well, it's the second church, really. First church when I was in California. I want you to picture a Quonset hut without air conditioning. You got it? In that congregation, there's about 60 people. It's hot, and it's summer. And a few get drowsy and go to sleep. Maybe you've heard this before. I was preaching at that time on going a little further. And if you remember the text, it goes like this. And Jesus went away, and when he came back, he said, "Could you not stay awake 1 hour?" I did that, and two men come jumping up out of their seats. It was during that period of time at the little town of Oakview in California that I did what young pastors do. I picked up the bulletins when all was said and done to see what they had doodled that day. Do you realize how many people doodle? How many of you have doodled on your bulletin? Come on, come on now, be honest. Few of you. Well, I got this picture of a doodler, but this was a beautiful picture. He had picked the person out of the choir. And it was a likeness that I hadn't seen before. So I began to ask the ushers, who did that? It was Dennis Botke. So I went to Dennis and I said, "Dennis, I want you to come to my house and do a painting." So he came, and when he came to my house, he was in his rough clothes because he thought I wanted him to paint a picture. No, he thought I wanted him to paint part of the house. But I said to him, "Dennis, what I really ask you to do," he's 16 years old. I said, "I want you to give me a picture that I can use in my ministry to tell people what it means to make the Lord's Supper modern." I said, "We have a cross that's been gilded. We don't have an old rugged cross in here, do we?" I said, "We don't do the tearing of the bread and having the crumbs fall on the table. Oh, everybody has to be polite. I want you to give me a picture of what it would be like if Jesus came. And second of all, I want that figure in that picture to be what every man and every woman might think about when they see the picture." He called me and he said, "You mind if I do it in chalk?" I said, "No, I don't care. This picture you see on the wall is Dennis's
understanding of communion. You know, when you look at a picture, what does it say to you? It says, first of all, to be a follower of Christ means that you go out into the world. You remember the scripture? Unless you take up your cross and follow me. You remember that? The cross is the streets for Dennis in California. About that time, they were putting in a tract house that was 56 tracts houses right behind the church, where they go in and they put the foundation in, and then they come through and they put the framing in, and then they do each one of those until they're all done and they all look alike. You remember that? That's Dennis's understanding. And I said to him, Dennis, you've done exactly what I wanted you to do. And then he said, Tom, I want you to look at the figure. This was done in 1963. Do you know what happened in 1963? John F. Kennedy was shot. It's in the making of that picture that Dennis said to me, I think he looks a little like Kennedy. But I'd like you to look at that picture and ask yourself, could I go out into the world like that man is going to do, to give my body and my blood because Christ died for me? Very interesting, and I'm only going to close with this. Dennis said this was one of the most important things that happened to him, was doing that picture. And then he was drafted. But before he got drafted, he joined the Air Force. And then he wrote me poems of what it felt like to be a bombardier during the Vietnam War. It can cost you, but God is with us, and he loves us. And I want you all to remember this. Go out into the world and be his disciples. Amen.